Friends, we live in an unforgiving age. In 2015, a British scientist, Sir Tim Hunt, a Nobel Prize-winning scientist, no less, made his visit to South Korea. The only thing is, in 2015, they haven't taught the South Koreans or say shalom. On his visit 4 years ago, he made, in the course of his speech, a bad joke about women in laboratories. It was a silly joke, and he admitted it, and it fell flat. However, one person tweeted the joke, and it went round the world and became viral. And thereafter, he became the target of an online shaming campaign, the end of which was he was forced to resign his position at University College London, forced to resign his position in the Royal Society, forced to resign his position in the European Research Council, and turned into a pariah, despite the fact that he obviously was only making a joke. Immediately afterwards, in his talk, said science needs women, despite the fact that his wife is a distinguished scientist, despite the fact that he apologized time and time again, despite the fact that he was defended by fellow scientists from Brian Cox all the way to His Holiness Richard Dawkins. The truth is, they were telling the world it was only a joke. And yet he was condemned without trial, without consideration of the evidence, without due process, without appeal, without mercy, without regard to his lifetime of service to science, without regard to the simple fact that he was a human being and human beings make mistakes. Ours is an unforgiving age. Jordan Peterson is a psychologist at the University of Toronto. He is probably the most followed public intellectual in the world right now. He has a huge following because he is a countercultural figure and he has the courage to challenge some politically correct positions. This summer, he was due to serve as a research fellow in the Cambridge Divinity School, which your rabbi knows well because he has been teaching there and will do so until the 30th of September this month, when he may lose his position because of what I'm about to say. But I'm sorry in advance, okay? Somebody discovered somewhere on Facebook that somebody unknown had taken a selfie with Jordan Peterson. And the somebody who took the selfie was wearing a t-shirt with a slogan on it that was not terribly nice. Now, hundreds of people on that night that Jordan Peterson gave a lecture wanted a selfie with him. Hundreds of people took a selfie with him. He had no chance of scrutinizing what the people who were taking selfies with him were wearing. He had no idea what was written on the t-shirt, and yet he was condemned. Who was he condemned by? The Cambridge Divinity School. Let me ask you, Michael Harris, have they heard of the word forgiveness in the Cambridge Divinity School? Or is that too recherché? Or maybe they've heard of the word justice. Here is a man condemned because of somebody else's selfie with him, somebody else's t-shirt, with no trial, no evidence, no judicial process, no reflective moral judgment, no v'darashta v'chakata v'sha'alta heitev, as the Torah tells us to do, to examine the evidence well and see if hinei emet nachon adavar, if the thing is true. None of that. Just simple condemnation. Now, I happen to have the privilege of knowing Jordan Peterson. I went to interview him at his home in Toronto. And we had a long conversation together, which you can hear in its entirety on the BBC website. Here is a serious human being, a man whose work is intensely moral, deeply spiritual, intellectually challenging. A person who is focused on what we are going to focus on tonight and for the next few days until Yom Kippur, the focus on taking responsibility for your life, not blaming other people, but taking responsibility. That's what Selichot are about. And yet nothing was said in his defense, not even from a faculty of divinity. Ours is an unforgiving age. So here was a man who made a slightly ill-judged joke, and here was a man who had the misfortune to have a selfie taken together with somebody wearing an inappropriate t-shirt, and these were the people for whom, in Maimonides' words, the gates of repentance were closed. Nobody gave them a chance to say, I'm sorry, or to explain, or to forgive, be forgiven. Nothing. And now consider two people who actually did wrong. Wrong so bad that we would understand if somebody said what they did was unforgivable. I think, first of all, of a young man who said these words, Ma betza ki narog et achinu. What profit will we get if we kill our brother? Come, let's sell him as a slave. Let's not kill him. After all, he's our brother, our own flesh and blood, who sold his brother as a slave. His name was Yehuda. That was a real, real sin. And yet he became the ancestor of Israel's kings. He became a lot more than that. We bear his name. We are called Jews because we are Yehudim, because we are named after Yehuda. Why? Because he was forgiven. And why was he forgiven? Because he owned up. He said, Aval Hashemim Anachnu, we were guilty. He said, in words we're going to say in Selichot soon, Ma nedaber u'ma nitzdadak. What can we say to justify ourselves? He said, Ha'elokim matza et avon avadecha. God has discovered, uncovered our guilt. What's more, he changed. From the person who sold his brother as a slave, he became the person who was willing to spend the rest of his life as a slave so that his brother Benjamin could go free. He became a Baal Tshuva. Joseph, his brother, forgave him. God forgave him. And it is his name we bear. Let me give you a second example. And here I talk about a king of Israel whose behavior was, well, how can I put it? In the immortal words of the late Leonard Cohen. Your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. I hope that doesn't need any Russian Tosafists for anyone. A king of Israel who had adulterous relationship with somebody else's wife and then sent her husband to the front line of the army. This was a horrendous sin. It was an appalling crime. And yet he became Israel's greatest sin. King. More than that, he became perhaps the greatest religious poet the world has ever known. Why? Because he was forgiven. And why was he forgiven? Because he said, in the shortest form of slichot ever delivered, in one word, chatati, I sinned. But he didn't just say that. He said, chatati, chatati, negdi tamid. My sin is in front of me all the time. I will never for one minute forget that I sinned. And so he was forgiven. So Judah and King David were Baalei Tshuva who confessed and apologized and they changed and they were forgiven. And they had committed serious wrongs, not jokes in bad taste or t-shirts in a selfie. And yet they were forgiven. Imagine they hadn't been forgiven. If Yehuda hadn't been forgiven, there would be no Jews today. Because it was Yehuda who survived when the 10 tribes in the north disappeared from history, the lost 10 tribes. If King David hadn't been forgiven, there would be no Book of Psalms today, and the whole world would be impoverished. What's the difference? The difference is because at the heart of our faith is a God who forgives. Vayoma Hashem salachti kidvarecha. God says to us, be honest with me and then I will forgive you. And then he says to us, as we'll say over and over again tonight and throughout Selichot, Hashem, Hashem, kel rachum v'chanun. God is a God of mercy and compassion. And when did he say those words? After the worst sin of all, the golden calf. 40 days after receiving the Torah on Mount Sinai, the worst sin of all, and God forgave. God forgives. What happens when an entire culture loses faith in God? I'll tell you, all that's left is an unconscious universe of impersonal forces that doesn't care if we exist or not. And in the other direction, all that's left is a world of Facebook and Twitter and viral videos in which anyone can pass judgment on anyone without regard to the facts or truth or reflective moral judgment. And by the time the person accused has had the chance to explain or the truth has emerged, the crowd has already moved on. They're not interested anymore. And what happens in an unforgiving culture? In an unforgiving culture, the people who survive and thrive are the people without shame. Have a look at who is powerful in the world today. And they are the people without shame. Because those are the only people who survive in a world without forgiveness. Whereas we believe that God gives us a chance to acknowledge our mistakes. And where, if we are honest about the wrong we have done, if tonight we stand before HaKadosh Baruch Hu with a broken heart, if we are willing to have the guts to say, Aval Hashemim Anachnu, we really did get it wrong, if we are able to say, like David HaMelech, Chatati, I sinned, then God gives us a second chance. And that is what Selichot are all about being honest, about being candid, about saying, Rabbono Shel Olam, I know I let you down, I know I let others down, I know I let me down, but Shema Koli, Shema Koleinu, listen to me, Rabbono Shel Olam. Hear my cry. Help me become the person you created me to be. A year or two ago, I was just about to give a lecture in a big shul in America. 1,000 people in the audience. And to get 1,000 Jews to sit down, hard as the division of the Red Sea is, you know. So we had a certain weight in front of us. And the rabbi of the shul, very sweet man, said to me, Rabbi Sacks, do you mind, we've got 10 minutes before we have to begin. Every week I do a radio program, the local Jewish radio program, and we've got 10 minutes, would you do an interview with me? So I said, fine. So we went into his study, just the two of us. And this is what he asked me. He said, Rabbi Sacks, I look at your CV. I look at your career. Tell me, Rabbi Sacks, did you ever fail at anything? I almost fell out of my chair laughing. I said, I have failed at almost everything. My favorite sentence in the English language is Winston Churchill's definition of success. You know his definition of success? Going from failure to failure without loss of enthusiasm. So I tried to explain to the rabbi, the real difference is not between failure and success. The real difference is between failing and giving up and failing and keeping on going. That's the real difference in life. And what keeps me going, I explained to him, is the simple knowledge that God lifts us when we fall, and God forgives us when we fail. So, I have one request of you. Forget the public persona of perfection that people post on their social media as their defense against an unforgiving world. Forget that. And know in our davening that in the inner reaches of our soul, we can be honest with ourselves. We can acknowledge the ways in which we failed and fell short, because we know that God forgives. And in that forgiveness, God gives us the strength to heal what we have harmed, to mend what we have broken, and to become the person he wants us to be. May Hashem give us that strength. Kenya Hiratzon Vanomar. Amen.